Hey, Grio fam, I'm Yodit, Tewolde, and I'm an attorney and journalist and advocate. And today we are gonna be talking about Breonna Taylor. It's incredibly important that we understand this case for what it is, where it stands legally. There's so many distorted facts and misconceptions out there. It's important that we get the facts straight, who the players are and what their respective roles are in the series of events that basically killed Breonna Taylor, and what their involvement was and what the legal standards are. And I'm gonna be having this conversation with an important colleague of mine, Marc Lamont Hill, and we're gonna be discussing this and breaking this down. And the information that we're gonna be basing this on is official records and statements and 911 recordings. So we're here to really get the record straight on this, and I couldn't have asked for a better person to talk about this with than Marc.
Yodit, I'm glad to talk to you because there have been so many conversations going on in the public about Breonna Taylor. We see memes, we see ads, we see news reports. The problem is, from where I sit, there's so much misinformation. I hear people say things that are true, things that are totally untrue, and I'm still trying to figure it out like everybody else. Can you first lay out sort of what the basic facts of the case are?
All right, so the basic facts. The Louisville Police Department, a detective went and applied for search warrants, specifically no-knock warrants, on March 12th. Got it approved, 5 in total. The next day, the narcotics investigation team went out on their operation and went to Breonna Taylor's apartment around midnight. And here's where it all kind of starts, right? There's some discrepancies. There's things that we all can agree on. And what we can agree on is that there were knocks. There were several knocks. And who was inside Breonna's apartment? Breonna and her boyfriend, Kenneth Walker. Kenneth Walker, according to him, both were in bed watching a movie, or more. He said, of course, the movie was watching them. So they woke up to a loud bang at the door. They both were startled by it, asked who was out there. Nobody responded. They heard another bang, and they're going back and forth asking who was outside, and nobody would answer. And so they got dressed, headed towards the front door down a hallway. And then that's when the doors busted open. And in response to what he believed were intruders, Kenneth Walker, you know, like, he fired off one shot. And then at that point, officers responded by, you know, unloading essentially and killing Breonna several times by, you know, she was punctured at least 8 times and she was found dead in her hallway. So that's essentially what occurred, and now we're sort of trying to piece together what's happening, you know, in the aftermath.
So that's really interesting. I mean, what you laid out is helpful. It's sort of stunning in the age of 24-hour cable news, all these reports, all these blogs. I mean, we have access to so much information, yet there's so much misinformation. I've heard lawyers, people who do civil rights cases, people who do wrongful death cases, lay out the wrong facts. I've seen journalists lay out the wrong facts. It seems to me that this is happening for multiple reasons. I mean, some of it is, I think people have agendas, and sometimes people tell the story that they want to tell.
Right.
I think sometimes people get bad information, and with no ill intent, they earnestly just share the information that they receive. And if information gets received 2 or 3 times, or God forbid it's on a meme, then it just becomes true, even if it's not. So let's start with before she even gets out of the bed. Right.
Right.
The argument is that one of the arguments that came up on the internet was that Breonna Taylor was killed by police who were at the wrong address, that the police came to the wrong house altogether. And I was trying to figure out why that narrative would be the case. Just to be clear, the warrant that the police had was for that house.
Correct. So there was 5 warrants in total, one of which was for Breonna's apartment. So Breonna was mentioned by name. She was identified by name, by address. So the police weren't there by accident. They meant to go there. And it was because they believed she had some ties with one of their main targets, Demarcus Glover. So, you know, at one point or another, they dated 2 years prior. And so they believed that she still had ties and that he had some packages going to her apartment. And those packages could have been illegal packages. And, you know, they thought that they could find evidence in her apartment. And so, no, they weren't there by accident. So, you know, the idea of them going to the wrong place was, I think, is something that was said early on, because Breonna Taylor was this EMT worker, no criminal history. What in the right. world could they have wanted from her? Clearly, they found their suspect somewhere else. Aha, they went to the wrong place.
Gotcha. So it may have been a bad decision or bad evidence. It could have been a bad, you know, choice to go to this house or to assume that she was more criminally involved than she was. I mean, we could look through all that. But in terms of the facts of the case, the police showed up to the right place. I think it's important for us to emphasize that just because the police showed up to the right place doesn't mean we're saying the police were right. We're Correct. Simply saying that the police who arrived were they came to the place they were supposed to go to.
Absolutely.
Okay. The next thing is, again, you started to talk about this idea that she was in bed. You know, I'm always struck by how perfect Black victims have yes. to be in order to get yes. that identity as victim. It's like, if she's walking down the hallway, she shouldn't get shot. If she's holding, something in her hand, an object in her hand, as the police surprise her and walk through the door, it doesn't mean she should die. Even if she were running at them with a knife, it doesn't necessarily mean that she should be shot, you know, eight times or shot at, you know, 20 plus times. So this idea that we have to put her in bed and say she's asleep, you know, fast asleep, it's like we have to make her so incontrovertibly innocent and docile in order to believe that she deserves the sympathy that white people get just for being human.
Exactly. And it's a dangerous line to toe, because we will have another Breonna Taylor, and she may not be someone who, you know, had no criminal history, was there helping people in a pandemic. And we're setting ourselves up for failure if we continue to try to make these victims angelic. We should just go with the facts, and the facts are she was in her own home and police officers shot her dead when she shouldn't have been.
Now there's another narrative that's come up, and it seems to be coming up from the sort of critics of Breonna Taylor, maybe even the enemies of Breonna Taylor, or at the very least the defenders of the police, who have said that Breonna Taylor was living with a drug dealer. That she was spending her nights and days with this drug dealer, and therefore yeah. the police, of course, were justified in coming in there guns a-blazing because they thought they were walking into a trap house.
Right. And it's the stain, so to speak, and it's for lack of a better term, of her having dealt with one. You know, she dated one, so clearly there's ties there. And not only that—
Wait, I'm sorry, just so I'm clear. You're saying she did actually at some point date a drug dealer. She simply wasn't dating one at that time and living with one at that time.
Yes, absolutely. So she, two years prior to her death, she dated one of the main suspects in the investigation, Jamarcus Glover. They had, after they broke up, and they had some sort of a passive relationship. He had a package that was mailed to her apartment in January of this year. And so they had a passive relationship, you know, like we do with most of our exes. But she was currently dating Kenneth Walker. And so people assumed that because a judge signed off on a warrant, that there was some credibility to what the officers were saying. No, the officers solely went on the fact that Jamarcus received a package in January. So therefore she must have had ties with him, or that he was using her apartment to stash away money or drugs. And so, nope, she wasn't living with a drug dealer. The only person that she was living with was her younger sister, who, thank God, wasn't there when Breonna was killed. But yes, Breonna, her sister, Kenneth Walker, none of them are drug dealers. None of them have had drug offenses on their record. So yes, that is a falsehood. It's another way of justifying what I think was an illegal search warrant. And it's also in an effort to justify her being killed. So no, not true.
So I'm glad you're breaking down these myths and you're separating the facts of the case from the fictions of the case. All of that is important for its own sake, right? We need to just yeah. know what's true. But there seems to be a particular detriment or danger when we have of bad information about high profile cases. As an attorney, what do you see as the biggest danger of that?
Well, we're kind of working against our interests. We're calling for charges in these high profile cases, and they don't actually go with what the facts are that people are pushing. So it's incredibly important to make accurate assessments of what our asks are by having the correct information. So we shouldn't get into this habit of pushing out false narratives. I get with, you know, the internet and the access to information being so easy that people could just make a mistake. But at this point, it's been 5 months now since Breonna died. The information is out there. It's just a click away. So, you know, I think that people just need to vet their information a little bit more than they are, and understand that in the greater efforts of getting justice, it's important that we're all on the same page.
Absolutely. And I think being on the same page is critical. Does it matter for potential jurors? Like if the entire country, for example, has this narrative that Breonna Taylor was, you know, living with dope dealers and involved in illicit activity, again, we say it shouldn't matter. It still shouldn't be, killed on your couch, or your bed, wherever. But if people, if the public narrative of her is an extremely negative one, does it do potential jurors or prosecutors a disservice?
Well, yeah, I think in terms of how involved the media is nowadays, especially with social media and you know, things going viral so quickly, any high profile case is always going to jeopardize to some degree a potential jury pool. I mean, it could be made, the argument could be made that, you know, the vilification of these officers could also impact a potential jury pool and give them a fair trial. So at the end of the day, whichever, if this case were to be, you know, charged, tried, and, you know, before a jury, that jury is going to get the facts correct in evidence. So they're going, even if they went into the case with these misconceptions, they should be set straight during the actual trial process when evidence and facts are being established for them. So, but no, it's always a danger. And you know, that's what the jury selection process is essentially about. You're asking each juror what they know about a case before they even get into the specifics. So you hope that jurors will be honest and say, well, yeah, I heard that this happened and I feel this way. And it's up for, you know, the prosecutor and the defense attorney in the case to make a determination whether that person can be fair or not. But yeah, you bring up a good point. All of these things that are being said are tainting a potential jury pool, but it's still important, I want to say, as journalists, you and I, to still be able to speak freely about these cases in the media in order to do what we're doing right now, and that's educating everybody on what the facts are.
You said these cases, you talked about prosecutors, you talked about potential defense attorneys, jurors, all that stuff is courtroom talk, and you don't get courtroom talk until you get charges, and you don't get charges until you get maybe an arrest, maybe a warrant, something. When we come back, I'd like to talk to you about why we don't have any of that stuff, because the world is clamoring for people to arrest the officers that killed Breonna Taylor. We don't have an arrest, and I'm trying my best to understand why, and you're the perfect person to tell me.